Good day, my dear followers. I am Dr. Javi, and today I would like to briefly introduce you to the world of basic robotics. As you might know, the word robot defines any machine that performs one or more specific tasks with some degree of autonomy. That is to say, robots must be able to take certain decisions on their own without any human guidance. There are two main kinds of robots: robot manipulators and mobile robots. A manipulator is a robot that is fixed to a single spot or to a very restricted area, but can adopt many different spatial configurations to reach points within its action radius. For instance, assembly line robots are most commonly manipulators. Mobile robots, on the other hand, can move around autonomously, usually calculating and following obstacle-free trajectories, but they cannot perform any other tasks. Unmanned vehicles and drones are examples of mobile robots. Of course, one could argue that a robot manipulator could be mounted on top of a mobile robot so that they may join forces and take over the world. However, from a computational point of view, each part will still need to be programmed independently. Now, here is a rather interesting fact. The inner functioning of robot manipulators is very difficult to calculate to human beings and ferries, but extremely simple to a computer, whereas mobile robots are really easy for us to understand, but exceedingly complicated for a machine. Let us see why. The most basic objective of a manipulator is to align its joints so that its final point, called end effector, reaches some target. This is a schematic diagram of a simple manipulator, like the ones my students work with, where the rotation and translation axis of each joint and the distances between them are defined. These data are enough to calculate where each joint of the robot is located in space relative to all previous ones and a global coordinate axis, usually located at the first joint. This calculation involves transformation matrices, which look like this. Scary, isn't it? Without getting into much detail, since I know some of my followers may not know what matrices are or how to work with them, this beauty here involves 4 trigonometric operations and about 20 products per joint. That means solving this simple manipulator requires over 100 products, which is rather costly for a person. But a computer can do all that and more, like this. We just need to explain to it how to make these calculations, which are actually rather easy to program, and our robot will follow any trajectory we want with barely any effort. If you would like to know more about how manipulators work, let me know in the comments below and I'll prepare another lesson about them. The main objective of a mobile robot, on the other hand, is getting from point A to point B without crashing into anything on its way there. This is very simple to a person, because we have basic pathfinding skills, but a computer will be immediately lost. Even if we give it a map, it still needs to know what the robot is like, where it is, how it can move, how it can see where it is going, how to find a valid route, and how to follow it without getting lost. So, we need to use some difficult tricks to teach a robot how to navigate. First of all, a mobile robot will always need a map of its environment, and we can either provide it beforehand, or it can compute it as it moves, which is known as simultaneous location and mapping. These maps are very different from the ones people use, since a robot cannot read street names, but it can instead identify colors, physical objects, landmarks, or anything its sensors allow it to detect. Now, how do we teach a robot how to use a map? For that, we use Bayes' theorem. Bayes' theorem tells us that the posterior probability of an event is proportional to its likelihood times its prior probability. This, in human language, means that a robot can estimate where it is from where it looks like it is and where it makes sense that it is. This formula is usually applied sequentially, since knowing where the robot might be now determines where it will make sense for it to be in the future. But let us see how it works with an example. Our little robot has been given a map of a city, showing landmarks it can detect with its sensors. It is a very simple town, it only contains churches, statues and bridges. The first thing the robot must do is check its prior probability, that is, its memory of past events. But it currently has no memory, so it can only assume that it is at least somewhere within the city. Internally, a robot typically represents that being somewhere as placing a little virtual copy of itself on each valid position of a digital map. These copies, called particles, know exactly what the real robot sees and how it moves, so they will try to copy its behavior as closely as possible. The system is called a particle filter. So, Now that our robot has used its particles to mark its prior probability, it needs to check its likelihood, that is, where it looks like it is, according to its sensors. Let us say that it currently sees a church. It will then check, one by one, which of its particles are coherent with this information. The robot knows that it is neither next to a statue or a bridge, so those particles who think so are mistaken and must be removed from the filter. At this point, the robot has a vague idea of where it might be, and it cannot do much other than moving. So it does, and when it does, so do all of its particles. And behold, by moving, its knowledge has shifted from where I am to where it makes sense that I am. It knew it was at a church, and it knows it has moved right. So logically, it must be right of a church. It has turned its past posterior probability into present prior probability. This operation is called convolution. So now we have closed our cycle and can begin anew. The robot has its prior information, so it needs to check its sensors to know its likelihood. Let us say that it now sees a statue. Here is where the combination becomes clearer. The robot's memory says it should be right of a church, and its sensors say it should be at a statue. That means it can only be at a statue that is right of a church. The cycle will continue as many times as needed until there is only one particle left, which will mark the only possible place where the robot can be within the map. Notice that this only happens when the robot hits a combination of landmarks that only exists once in the whole map. This is also what people do. To find a position within a map, we will walk around until we find a distinct landmark which we can identify accurately. If that were just the name of a street, we would follow it until we found a corner, that is, a second landmark to complement our information. Now, there's a little problem with particle filters. Sensors like, it is not their fault, they're doing their best, but every available sensor device, no matter how accurate and expensive, will make mistakes and give faulty measurements all the time. That means that, when a robot saw a church, it may not have been so, and it might have discarded the wrong particles because of that. So how do we fix this problem? By using statistics. When we program a robot, we do not only have to tell it what the world is like using a map, we must also explain what the robot itself is like. The robot must be aware of what kind of mistakes its sensors make, and this error must be modeled as accurately as possible. So when the robot sees a church, it will not say, I see a church. It will say, for instance, I am 75% sure that I see a church, but the odds that it is actually a bridge are 20%, and so on. And the same thing happens to its movement. When the robot moves one step in some direction, it might have slipped a little or moved a shorter distance than it thought, or maybe one of its legs or wheels hit a pebble and it accidentally turned a little bit, so it is no longer facing the direction it thinks it should be. But the robot knows it can make these mistakes, and it knows how often they happen. So, when it moves, it will also say, I have moved 1 meter to my right, give or take 1 centimeter, give or take 5 degrees, and so on. Now, you might think that robots are pretty flawed in this regard, but here's the thing. You are too. Think about it. Surely you know the layout of your home by heart, but when there is a blackout and you need to walk through a corridor, what is the first thing you do? You touch a wall. Why? Do you not trust your legs? You actually do not. Because you know every little mistake your legs make will throw you off course, so you need additional information not to crash into a wall. You do not just need convolution, you need likelihood. When there is light, you can use your eyes to subtly correct your drift, but when your eyes are not good, you instinctively look for an alternative. So how does this all translate into our particle filter? Now the robot can never be sure enough of where its particles should go or what they see, but it can use their weight. The more certain a particle is about its position, the heavier it will be. So now particles do not just disappear when they are wrong, they become lighter and lighter. Once the robot realizes the weight difference between particles is too big, it will resemble them. It will take the particles that are too light, reposition them next to the heavier ones, and equalize their weights. There are a lot of different algorithms to know when it is right to resample and how to do it, but it is usually done pretty much at random. Now, when there are several particles at the same spot, they can also copy the real robot's movement more accurately. The robot knows it can make mistakes, it might move further than expected or not far enough, but the particles will also try to simulate that error. That way, a group of particles that are placed at the same spot will gradually drift apart, thus covering more ground and helping the robot find its actual position more accurately. Notice that, since all movements will produce errors, the robot should not stop using Bayes' theorem once it finds out its location, as it can still get lost after a few steps. So, its particle filter remains active for as long as the robot keeps moving, and, in the same way that we use our eyes to correct our drift, the robot will use its particles. So now you know how a mobile robot moves through the world without getting lost. I could also explain how they find their way from one point to another, but that is an entirely different lesson. If you would like me to make another video about navigation or how robot manipulators are programmed, just let me know in the comments below. For now, I hope that you enjoyed this little lesson on basic robotics. Thank you for your attention, and I hope to see you again soon.